What's up, friends, and welcome to today's video. I'm going to try and do this Q&A, like, straight through for minimal editing and maximal turnaround time, okay? Because I've been a little bit more behind on my YouTube game than I want to be. So, let's get into it. Obviously, I posted a question box on my Instagram, so that's where the questions are coming from. If you would like to ask preguntas, make sure you keep an eye on my Instagram story, because that's where I ask them, or that's where I get them, right? So, first cue, how to overcome constant thoughts and binging at night after an on-track day of food. So, I will tell you, I grew up as a snacker, and I know it might not seem like it now that I have my shit together in terms of, like, tracking my macros and not, like, screwing that up after going through a couple of preps and whatnot, but when I first started tracking my macros, I would be perfect all day, and I would finish them at like 7 p.m., and then I'd eat a bunch of cereal and peanut butter. Why? Cereal was like the death of me, and I know a lot of people struggle with binging on cereal. Listen, first step, don't buy it. Keep it out of the house. But second step is obviously more mental, so the question is about, like, thoughts focusing on food. And here's the thing. I know it's tough, and it sucks when you feel like you're never gonna get past it, but over time, this will get better, okay? Like, both times, or like every single time that I diet, I'm like, I'm not extremely food focused. The first prep, I was. Last prep, I was not. But that's just because over time, you just, I don't know, you get further into this and it's not a thing. But with food thoughts, I think the biggest thing that helped me was, like, staying out of the kitchen and focusing on, like, what else is important in my life besides food? Like, a lot more, right? Food is awesome, but it will always be there. We live in a very abundant society. Food is not scarce. The fun stuff will always be at the grocery store, so you don't need to buy it all at once. And honestly, even to this day, when I see something fun at the grocery store and I'm like, ooh, I can make that fit my macros, I tell myself, not this time. If you still want it the next time you go to the store, then you can get it. And usually I just forget about it. You know what I mean? So it's like, does this serve you? You know, does this extra food serve you? Sometimes it does. Sometimes your soul needs that extra food. But most of the time, if you have physique goals, aka you're tracking macros, the food is not gonna serve you. So I would say on the other side of this, if you are struggling with, like, pretty serious, like, food focused thoughts and you are binging or you have any kind of restrictive eating tendencies, any cycles like that, obviously, like, reach out for the support that you need from a professional. There is no shame in that, and I'm not qualified to give that kind of advice, but just in terms of getting through the mental side of things, I think focusing on things other than food, right, and just realizing it's gonna get better over time. So there's that. Also, don't buy stupid shit at the grocery store. I know it's hard. Plan your food in advance. Plan your food the night before. The entire time I've tracked macros, which has been like 5+ years now, I always structure my day around my favorite meal, which is my final meal, and it's something sweet. So that's a huge hack. I would definitely start there as well. How did you become so confident and secure in yourself and your calling? So I will tell you, I have my days where I'm not feeling so confident and not feeling so secure, but obviously I've come a long way, and a lot of that is due to personal development, because the issues are much, much deeper than being like, oh, I'm just not a confident person. Like, nah, dude, you're struggling with something so much deeper that happened in your childhood. And I'm not saying you have to have had anything crazy happen to you. You don't have to have experienced, like, an acute trauma. Like, it can be something very chronic over time, but during our childhood, that is when we are shaped, right? That's when we create our belief systems based on what we're learning and what we're experiencing, and everybody has their shit. So I would highly, highly encourage you to do any form of personal development, whether it's reading a book, journaling, reaching out to a personal development coach. That's gonna take you to where you wanna be a lot quicker than you would otherwise. So another piece of it is just speaking and living things into existence. Like when I first started coaching, I was terrified to call myself a coach. And now I'm like, yeah, I'm a coach. Like it's normal, right? So over time you will normalize it as long as you speak it into existence and live in alignment with that, right? So just step into your power, like own that shit. Because if you don't take yourself seriously, no one else will. What was the most embarrassing thing that happened to you as a kid? I don't have anything in particular. I mean, no, I really don't think there's anything in particular. I know when I was like pretty little, like I don't really remember getting hurt, but I remember my lip being fucked up from this and like my parents telling me the story, but at my grandma's house, there was like this little ledge, like here's the ground, here's the freaking ledge. My bitch ass fell off it and like busted my lip, busted my shit. Like you could see, like it was like bigger on one side for like years, I swear. Cause my mom just held it closed and I probably should have had stitches, but we made it. Favorite places to buy non-gym clothing. So this is a really good question because I don't really wear non-gym clothing. And I know there's like tons of different opinions about like fast fashion. So things like Forever 21 or Fashion Nova, like you can find some dope shit at those places for like a very affordable price point. But obviously the quality is gonna be a little bit sacrificed. But in terms of, I remember when I wore like business professional clothes, I would shop at Express. I would shop at Loft. That was another one that I really loved. There was one other one. I can't even remember, dude. Like, I don't buy real person clothes, but American Eagle is coming back around, okay? I was obsessed with American Eagle when I was in, like, high school, and then it got weird, and now I'm, like, about it again. I really like H&M. I don't know, man. I don't really have, like, my set places, because, again, I don't buy normal people clothes. I would love to be a freaking fashion blogger, okay? That is something I feel called to do, is create cute outfits and share them, but I'm just not there yet, okay? If you guys have recommendations for fave places to buy non-gym clothes, comment below and I'll probably be like, oh duh, I forgot that one. Peaks and pits of lockdown. So the good news is I'm not actually alone because I live with Lexi, right? I would be losing my mind if I did not have her. And I think this is also a good time for all of us to turn inward, to grow, and to come back to a place of gratitude, because you are not truly grateful for what you have until it's taken away, AKA our freaking freedom, okay? So that's a peak, I guess. I've never heard that phrase before, peaks and pits. My friend from New Zealand asked this, so maybe that's like a across the world kind of phrase, but pits, I'm assuming, are like the downfalls of quarantine. I fucking miss everything. The gym, my friends, the beach, restaurants, lashes, massages, Brazilians. Okay, I am about to lose my mind. We are in week 6. It took me 6 weeks to lose it. That is what I will say about that. What do you love most about your physical appearance? So, I would say my eyeballs. My eyeballs. Will you ever intuitively eat? Does tracking mentally hinder that? So absolutely yes, I'm not gonna track forever. I can see myself transitioning to intuitive eating pretty soon, to be quite honest. Right now I'm trying to grow even without the gym. And with that, like, you cannot intuitively eat and reach a fitness goal, right? Because if your fitness goal, unless your fitness goal is to maintain or like very, very slowly progress, either way, right? But if your goal is to gain muscle, like be very intentional about growing, you're gonna have to eat past satiety, like past what your body wants, right? You have to put yourself in a surplus. Well, that's not intuitive because you're way too full. Opposite holds true for a diet. If you're hungry, but you want to lose body fat, you gotta be hungry. Intuitive eating, you're staying right here. Like, you eat when you're hungry, you stop when you're full. So it's not really conducive to physicals, but eventually, yeah, I will absolutely be intuitive eating. And it's gonna be a beautiful thing. I'm really excited. I could totally do it now, but I'm just being intentional about growing because this is like my post-show period. And for some time, you are like a little extra anabolic. I'm removed from that now. But also, when we go back to the gym, I have a theory that we're all gonna have a little taste of newbie gains. So I want to make sure I'm eating enough to, you know, actually reap the benefits from how much I kill myself in the gym, okay? Because I work freaking hard and I want to make sure that I'm not getting in my own way by under eating. So, wow, yeah. I'm chatting so much in this Q&A. If you're maybe you're doing cardio. Maybe. I don't know. Whatever. Hopefully you're enjoying this. Will I change my last name when married? Yes. I'm planning on it. My last name dies with me anyway, so I've just retired it early because... Okay, my last name is Ebling. I guarantee you, you were just like, what? Don't say what! It is so easy! Ebling. Ebling. It is spelled just like it sounds. E-B-L-I-N-G. And so many people, they'll be like, what's your last name? Like, Ebling? And they're like, what? And I'm like, what did you mean? What? I don't know how to make it more clear. But then some people, like, I'll give them that whole story and then I say it and they're like, oh yeah, it's just like it sounds. And I'm like, listen, mofo, if I wouldn't have prefaced it with all that, you would have said what? So yeah, I retired my last name early because I'm an only child and there are no boys to pass on the name. Okay. What is your nighttime routine for a good night's sleep? Get off your screens a couple hours before you go to sleep or wear blue blockers. I really don't fuck around on Instagram much after like 7 or 8 p.m. When I lay down, I'm gonna be honest, I check it one more time. I watch a couple stories and then I put that shit away and I roll over and I go to bed. I also wind down watching Gossip Girl, so that could be helpful. Somebody asked for another hilarious drunk story time, and I honestly, obviously I looked at these questions before, and I don't, like, I can't think of a specific one right now, and this video is already pretty long, but I'll have to think on that, and maybe in a future video I can share, because I know that I did share my 21st birthday story last time, which is pretty funny, but yeah, I'll have to think on that. What are my top three life goals? I don't know if I can like list out three specifics, but my goals all tie back to making the biggest impact as possible. So reaching as many people as possible, whether that is through speaking or coaching or live retreats, like whatever the case may be, I just want to impact as many people as possible because I know that I can help people. I have, but I just want to see that on like a much wider scale because, listen, we can all change the world. We can. If we just come together, spread the right message, right? And I want to be like the catalyst for that. Not that I'm sitting here being like, I am Melissa Jane and I can change the whole world by myself. Because, I mean, that's a pretty big task. But it ain't impossible, okay? Teamwork makes the dream work. And yeah, that is what I want to do. I do want to speak. I do want to travel for speaking purposes, for business purposes. And again, just make the biggest impact that I can, whether it's speaking to coaching, you know, group, one-on-one, whatever. What originally inspired me to compete? So it was like my junior year of college, which would have been like 2014/15, and I stumbled on to fitness social media, aka Nikki Blacketer and Christian Guzman, and I saw them competing, and I was like, whoa. Like, I had already been lifting for a little bit. I thought I had my shit figured out, and I was like, I need something more. I need to level up. I need more out of this. And I was like, I guess I'm gonna compete. So I knew I had like some work laid out for me in terms of, you know, you're gonna have to grow first. Like, I was not ready to step on stage, even when I did, honestly. But yeah, that's kind of what originally inspired me to compete. It didn't come from a place of like, I need to get super lean. It was like, yo, that looks dope. I'm gonna do it. And when I decide to do something, you already know, it happens. What is the biggest difference I've noticed between Kansas City and San Diego? So honestly, I thought that this would be worse here. I guess it depends where you are, but just like people being like uppity. Like, there are certain places in Kansas City that it's like very wealthy people who are up on a pedestal, and I just like didn't like those vibes. And obviously there are tons of great people in Kansas City. It's the Midwest, right? Like, people are nice, but obviously there's certain places you go and you're like, not my vibe. When I come to San Diego, I was like, okay, like California's expensive, like people here make a lot of money, like whatever. I have not really gotten the impression from anyone that they're like super uppity. I mean, maybe I've had a couple experiences, like once at Massage Heights, the girl at the desk was not very nice to me, but she like never worked. Like that was like one time I saw that girl. The people there are usually so nice. The people everywhere here are pretty nice. Like I have never had anybody like get in my face or like give me an actual dirty look. Like I feel very chill here in San Diego, which is freaking dope. First place I'm going after quarantine, the gym, and then directly down the street to the beach, okay? Because my gym is literally called The Gym, and it is down the street from Pacific Beach. By down the street, I mean like, you know, 10, 12 minutes, but that is where I'm going. That used to be our Friday routine. We would go lift and we go to the beach. I miss it so bad. Do I believe in soulmates? Yes, I do. How did I get into mindset / self-development work? So, you guys know, I always say law school was basically very expensive personal development, but I didn't realize it at the time. So I don't think that really counts. I think what counts is I moved here in March, like a year ago. So, or 13 months ago. The very first person that I like met up with out here, aside from Lexi, was my personal development coach now. So we connected through Instagram. He asked me for coffee. Like I didn't even realize he was like, I was his ideal client or he's like a personal development coach. Like I was like, okay, cool. Like I'm ready to meet new people. I just moved here. Like, let's go. And it was awesome. Like we had a really good conversation. And then we met up a few times over the summer, anytime that he was down here in San Diego, cause he lives in LA. And again, great conversation after great conversation. And then I realized, I was like, oh shit. I was like, this guy could be my coach. But he never like was pushy or anything. He literally was just like, oh, like if you ever want to have a conversation about how I can support you, like just let me know. But we continued to get coffee and like they're just like such, when you vibe with someone, you vibe, right? So that's kind of how that started. I signed up with him in August, I think, because it's been just over 6 months of coaching with him. And that's what got me started. And he has changed my freaking life. Honestly, I'm just going to shout him out right here because I know some of you guys are probably curious. His Instagram, I will put wherever on the screen here. It's at Jacob Kaufman. His name is Jake Kaufman. And that man is doing what he is supposed to be doing. I would not be anywhere near where I am right now without him. And he's not like a business coach, okay? It's not because of like business strategy. It's because of like personal development, like very deep inner work that he has taken me through. He's changed my life. Like, that's all I can say. Are you going to do a bikini competition in 2020? Nah. Okay, that is all of the questions, and this actually didn't turn out as long as I thought it would. So you're welcome for making sure it wasn't crazy, crazy long, but I really do love doing these. So let me know if you like them. Keep an eye on my Instagram for more Q&A boxes. Honestly, I'd be down to do these like every other week. If you guys have topics that you want me to dive into, if you want to get to know me a little bit better, like whatever, I'm pretty much an open book, right? So thank you for watching as always. And I think that's all. So if you watched until now, I am taking all my good vibes. I'm sending them your way. If you could give the video a thumbs up, subscribe, and hit that bell before you leave, that would be dope, and I will catch you in the next one. Bye!